الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف المرسلين سيدنا ونبينا ومولانا محمد صلى الله تعالى عليه وسلم وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. It's an honor and a privilege again to have Moulana Sarfaraz Hamza. We thank him for being here. We welcome him, inshallah.
إن الحمد لله إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونؤمن به ونتوكل عليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له ونشهد أن سيدنا ومولانا محمدًا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه بارك وسلم تسليمًا كثيرًا كثيرًا وبعد. Respected علماء, حفاظ, elders, brothers and sisters, السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. All praise and thanks is due to Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, nourisher, cherisher, sustainer of all the worlds, choices, blessings upon his beloved Nabi Muhammad Mustafa sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has sent with this complete way, this complete deen of al-Islam. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept it from us. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala purify our intentions and allow us to derive full benefit of our good deeds and forgive our shortcomings and allow us entry into Jannah through his mercy, inshaAllah. At the outset, I want to ask your forgiveness. I've got a bit of a cold. So if I take a break now and again, please just forgive me for that. Allah grant shifa, inshallah.
Amen.
And all those who I know, Allah grant shifa, inshallah. So during the month of Ramadan, I've had an opportunity to share and interact with different communities, sharing different Jumuah platforms. Not only Jumuah platforms, but in other ways as well, either through the radio or through talks after Taraweeh. And during this time, I've chosen to highlight the issue of Ramadan around the aspect of giving. And one may think, why speak about giving during the month of Ramadan when we should be giving throughout the year? And I want to change it up a bit. I want to speak about it from a different angle and a different understanding, because despite the fact that many of you know that your zakat or fitrah or fidya is due, many people give it as they've just given something off, and they don't understand the implications of what they have done or why they are giving. To add on to that, the month of Ramadan is a month which Muslims generally choose to discharge their zakat, because either we have forgotten when we became sahib e nisab. Those who don't know what sahib e nisab is, sahib e nisab is really meaning the companion or the possessor of nisab. Nisab is the minimum amount of wealth that you need to have before zakah becomes fard upon you. So zakah is not fard upon everybody. Zakah is fard upon the one who is in possession of nisab. So once you have become sahib nisab, that day that you have become sahib nisab is actually the day of your zakah that will be due every year. But because people don't remember, or they were not alerted to the fact that they have become sahib al-nisab, so they don't remember, so they choose a date that they will easily remember. And most people choose and become conscious of it during the month of Ramadan. And so many people choose either Muharram or the month of Ramadan to discharge the zakat. So it's important also for that reason. The next reason it is also important to speak about this is because our Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in a lengthy hadith narrated by Salman, says that on the last day of Sha'ban, he speaks to the companions and he says to the companions that very a great month has dawned upon you, or is dawning upon you. شَهْرٌ فِيهِ لَيْلَةٌ خَيْرٌ مِنْ أَلْفِ شَهْرٍ. In this month, there is a night that is better than 1,000 nights, obviously referring to the night of Qadr. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam goes on to say that whoever does a fard in this action, it is as if though he's done 70 fard in another month, And whoever does an optional action in this month is as if though he has done a fard in any other month. And then the Prophet ﷺ proceeds by giving the name this month a few names. One of those names he says is وَهُوَ شَهْرُ الصَّبْرِ. This is the month of sabr, a month of patience. وَالصَّبْرِ ثَوَابُ الْجَنَّةِ. And for sabr, the reward is only Jannah. And then he goes on to say وَهُوَ شَهْرُ الْمُوَاسَاتِ, that this is the month of sympathy or empathy. The month of sympathy or empathy. And this is the fact or the point that I wish to highlight here today. Because I want to take you to the spiritual part of giving as well. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allow me to follow first in these footsteps. When we are shown kings or royalty, whether it's a movie that depicts it, or whether it's a picture, a piece of art in history, and we see a king walking through a village, we see him holding his nose up, and then a pauper comes to him and grabs hold at the bottom of his top or his long gown and says, please, is there anything that you can give me? And the king with his nose up in the air and his hand up drops maybe a gold coin or silver coin in the hand of the pauper, in the hand of the pauper. And what is interesting to note about that image is that Islam does not teach us to give as if though we are doing the poor a favor. It teaches us to give as if though the poor is doing us a favor by allowing us to get the reward from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is very important to understand when we understand that this is Shahrul Muwasat, the month of giving. Many people in the next few days who are falling behind and have not realized that the zakah is due, because people only wake up at the end of Ramadan and they will discharge their fitrah and their fidyah as well. Don't feel when you give that fitrah and fidyah and zakah that you are doing a favor. Understand that a favor is being done for you. So much so that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, خُذْ مِنْ أَمْوَالِهِمْ. And the ayah goes on, but I want to highlight the fact that خُذْ مِنْ أَمْوَالِهِمْ, it is the responsibility of the state, if it's an Islamic state, to take from the wealth of those less fortunate. And there are Muslim countries that deduct your zakat from your account. Because it is the responsibility of the state to take that zakat from you. But because we are not in an Islamic state, there is so much wealth that is hoarded, that is kept away in Islamic investment accounts, in non-Sharia compliant accounts, that it is estimated roughly, and I've mentioned this figure before, in excess of R1 billion zakah is due every year. Now I ask you, brothers, you may have heard me speak about this before if you were at one of the other places, but I find it is my duty. I used to be involved in the NGO sector for a long, long time. Well, for me, a long time. For many people, it's a short time. But we were exposed to different situations and different things, and it's our duty to speak about it. All of us, not only my duty, everybody here, to speak about the fact that 3% of the population of South Africa approximately can make a huge difference with R1 billion that can be given to those less fortunate. But I guarantee you, and we've done a rough calculation, if you add up the amount of zakat collected privately by the NGO sector, by other forms of distributors and collectors of zakat, you will not come close to the figure of 1 billion. So that means there is also ignorance in our community or people not willing to discharge the zakat. Now we can stand here and speak about the rules of zakat. Like I always give the example, a man owns a garage, he comes to me every year. He says, ask me, Sheikh, not that I'm deserving of the title, but Sheikh, how much must I pay zakat? I said, what do you mean? You must pay 2.5% zakat. He says, no. Do I have to pay zakat on the petrol in the tanks underground? I said, yes, you must pay zakat with this stock in trade. He said, do I pay zakat on the cost of that petrol? Do I pay zakat on the retail amount of that petrol? Or do I pay zakat? And the answer is, you pay zakat on the current market value of that petrol. But these questions come here, and it's good that people are asking these questions, because it means that they are becoming conscious of the zakat. They are taking stock, they are taking hisab, they are taking account of what is due, what is not their duty, what is not their right. And that is why someone who receives zakah is called a mustahiq, someone who is entitled to zakah. And someone paying zakah is referred to as a muzakki, someone who pays zakah. And we need to develop zakah in South Africa in such a way, and sometimes we don't see the necessity of this. When we give our zakah to a particular organization, we want to know how much is used for admin. It's good. Ask how much is used for admin. But don't become distant when you find out the amount that is being used for admin. I tell you why I say that. And we'll go through this very briefly because that's what I want to speak about here. With the issues of globalization, you find that zakah needs to go much further in many cases. Sometimes people are sending zakah to very needy people in their country of origin. Sometimes they are sending zakah to Palestine, to Syria. People are sending zakah. And the cost of transporting that zakah, whether it be capturing it in a computer, whether you are taking the zakah down the road to a rural community, there is a cost involved in distributing that zakah. So don't be deterred because you see there's an admin cost on your zakah. Furthermore, if you are concerned about your zakah, you should not only be encouraged to pay the admin cost of your zakah, but if you want, rather add an element of sadaqah or lillah with your zakah so that they can cover the admin cost of distributing that zakah. Another point you can also make and understand is that the issue of distributing zakah, these organizations or people who have been placed in charge of our community, or the community accepts as legitimate distributors of zakah, they are doing us a favor by taking it. Many of us don't have the courage, the gumption, the ability to leave the warmth of our homes, to go in cold rural communities, and where we should be going, and finding the people who zakah is due to, and distributing zakah to those people, with the conditions and understanding, because you go into a community, you don't know the community, you've not interacted with the community the whole year, you don't know who's lying, who's the truth, who's practicing Islam, who's not practicing Islam, you don't know. When you close your eyes and give it to the organization, you trust that the organization has taken that responsibility to do that work for you. So I want us not to just close our eyes and give it to the organization. I want us to, as a community, you know, government gets pressure when there is, when society, civil society puts pressure on them. When we demand things, when we put our foot down and say we're not standing for this anymore, it puts pressure on civil society, puts pressure on government. Civil society must also put pressure on these organizations and get involved and ask them, how are you developing zakah? Because on the day of Qiyamah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will ask you, you gave it, but what more responsibility did you take? Why it may not have been fard for you? According to the fiqh masala, you gave it, you discharged your zakah. But is there a genuine interest in resolving the issues of the poor and the needy? And this is why Ramadan Shahrul Mawasir, you need to empathize with that poor person. Feel what it feels like and sympathize with them. You need to feel what it feels like to stay in a house that cannot keep the cold away. In these winter nights, in these rainy nights, may Allah grant us beneficial rain, inshaAllah. So we need to empathize and sympathize. You can't just say this is Ramadan is the month of fasting, it is the month of Taraweeh, it's the month of Quran, but the Quran and Taraweeh which encourages Jamaah, Quran which encourages Jamaah, encourages you to look after the poor, Salah which encourages Jamaah, Ramadan which encourages you to feel the way poor people feel as one aspect of it, Hajj which encourages Jamaah can be done only in Jamaah. These things, in fact Jumuah is about Jamaah, where it gets its name from. It is about Jamaah, but we don't want to feel, we want to say, we feel the pain of those less fortunate. We want to say that the Muslim Ummah is like one body. If others feel the pain, we should feel the pain. How many people have not heard about the message of Islam because of our laziness? It's an indictment on the Muslims in South Africa, as many people will regard it, that we've been here and boast about 300 and odd years legacy in South Africa, but still many people in South Africa have not heard La ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So our zakah needs to be given with empathy. Feel when you give that zakah. Put your hand down and give zakah from your hand being down. And let the taker take from on top. feel the humility and understand they are doing a favor for you. We can speak at length, like I said, about the many aspects of zakat and the importance of giving. And the Prophet ﷺ mentioned in numerous hadith about the benefits of those who give their zakat, who discharge their zakat. But I want to say here today that sometimes, while we cannot cover all the aspects in one Jumu'ah talk, it is important that we know where our zakat should go to. Before I come to that, I want to just say this statement in passing, that we need to put pressure on the organizations to be able to keep track of those less fortunate in South Africa. Keep record and register of it, and put them into the 8 categories of zakat, so that we can see the difference that is being made year on year with regards to how impactful our zakat is in our communities. Because we want the 8 categories of zakat to diminish. And if you want the 8 categories of zakat to diminish, you will not know if your zakat made a difference. So we need to give them the power to be able to employ people in research of zakat. They need to research the topic of zakat in such a way that they are keeping track and that they can make academic progress also on the issues of zakat in South Africa, in a Muslim minority country. There are very few Muslim minority countries that can keep track of the meaningful difference that zakat is making. And while we know it's making a difference in our community, many people have accepted Islam through the generosity of Muslims. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala increase our rizq, inshaAllah. You know? And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said in that same hadith later on, he says, وَوَ شَهْرٌ يَزَادُ فِيهِ رِزْقُ الْمُؤْمِنِ, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala increases the rizq of a mu'min in this month. And you know, when your wife prepares the food for you, before iftar, you could have eaten half a dozen samosas. And you will swear by everything that is good in your life that you will finish half a dozen samosas. But come to the iftar table, and after you've eaten one item, you will lose everything that's good in your life because of the promise you made. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala puts barakah. How? Maybe our stomachs become smaller, and Allah puts barakah. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, remember, the food for two is sufficient for three. The food for two is sufficient for three. So there is a lot of rizq in the month of Ramadan. But I want to come to a very important point about zakat. We can speak about the calculation of zakat. We can speak about the benefits of zakat. We can speak about the spiritual advantage of zakat. We can speak about the economic in dunya, the economic reward of zakat. You give people zakat, that man shops, and that man, he buys something at that man's shop, that man in turn buys something at your shop. You are creating wealth in your community when you distribute zakat. And if you want to research that in Muslim countries, you will see from an economic perspective. And that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that giving charity increases wealth, and riba diminishes wealth. Because when you give charity, you encourage healthy economic activity in your community, and your wealth can only increase. It's amazing that if you study zakat properly, you will find that you don't have to mint more money to put into the economy. You can just encourage giving zakat, and you will see that economy will flourish because of the moving of finances within that community. That is another aspect of looking at zakat. But I want to touch on the ayah, because many people, we need to go home with something beneficial, inshaAllah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, إِنَّمَا الصَّدَقَاتِ لِلْفُقَرَاءِ وَالْمَسَاكِينِ وَالْعَامِلِينَ عَلَيْهَا وَالْمُؤَلَّفَةِ قُلُوبَ وَفِي الرِّقَابِ وَالْغَارِمِينَ وَفِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ وَابْنِ السَّبِيلِ فَرِيضَةً مِنَ اللَّهِ وَاللَّهُ عَلِيمٌ حَكِيمٌ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran speaks about sadaqah, about zakat. Sadaqah is the broad term, but the narrow term, zakat and lillah. One is optional and one is compulsory. 2.5% of our surplus wealth. We can speak about calculations on another time. The South African National Zakat Fund had a conference which it explained in depth the issues of zakat. But unfortunately, we were preparing for Ramadan and trying to make sure that our freezers were stocked up, so we missed the conference. Not myself, but I mean, I think that's important. When we see issues like this, it's so important, zakat, because it is five pillars. Bunyan Islam ala khams. Islam is built on five pillars. And one of the most neglected pillars is zakat. People know a lot about a lot of the pillars, about many of the pillars, but very few people retain the information with regards to zakat. And it is a mission that we need to take up. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, your zakah can be given to 8 categories of people. Lil-fuqara, for those who are faqir. And who is a fuqara? Someone who is poor. Someone who is extremely poor, who doesn't have enough. They may be staying in a house, but they are struggling to pay the rent of that house. They maybe have a mode of transport, but they are unable to even fill petrol in the vehicle to move from point A to point B, and they are not in the state of nisab. That is a faqir, someone who is really in need, right? That person is a poor person, that person can be given zakah. The second category, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, wal masakin, those who are miskin. Now miskin are those people who are destitute. You don't have a house, you don't have a car, you have nothing. You are very, very so poor. Leave alone the rent of your house, you don't even have a house to stay in. You are living outside, sleeping in a masjid, going from pillar to post, good Muslim person, not in position of nisab. That person is a miskin. I'm giving you general definitions of the ayah as I'm breaking it down, so that we can leave here understanding. Next year when we come, we mustn't have the same questions. We must understand, read the Quran, and understand where the ayah of what the ayat of zakah means, who we can give. Fuqara wal masakin wal amilina alayha. The third category is those people who are working in the job of zakah. Their job is to collect zakah and their job is to distribute zakah. They are entitled to a portion of that zakah to get the job done and to see to their daily needs. For example, someone is going to take the day to take everybody's zakah to collect it. Who's going to work for him? Where must he get his money from? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala thought about this when he sent the Quran already. It's not for us to decide. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَالْعَامِلِينَ عَلَيْهَا, those who have working in zakah, they are entitled to take a portion of zakah. So when you give your zakah and you see there's an admin cost, don't become deterred, don't become scared. That is a category that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has permitted. But not any Dick, Tom and Harry. In an Islamic state, the Qadi will appoint a zakah collector. In a Muslim minority country, then we will have a general consensus of who are those that are able to collect zakah, and they are entitled to take their cost of distributing that zakah and their basic living expenses from the value of zakah. We can speak about the issue of amilin or amilun at length. But suffice to say that this is the third category of people who are entitled to zakah. وَالْمُؤَلَّفَ فِي قُلُوبِ, those people whose hearts are inclined towards the deen. So for purposes of da'wah, you can use zakah. For purposes of da'wah, you can use zakah. Now there is a difference in opinion amongst ulama about what is considered and who is considered مُؤَلَّفَ فِي قُلُوبِ, those whose hearts are inclined towards the deen. Is it a Muslim whose iman is weak, or is it a non-Muslim who is inclined towards the deen? And because of this, there's a general consensus that it includes both. As long as, and some people go with a very liberal interpretation of mu'allafat al-qulub, they say, even if they are non-Muslims who are not at war with Muslims, then you are permitted to use zakah for that purposes as well, because it will encourage them. They will see the beauty of Islam. They will come and you will have an opportunity to do da'wah. You will explain to them about the oneness of Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So you are permitted to use zakah for that purposes as well. Wal-gharimi, right? Gharimi is someone who is over indebted. Now, many people are hearing this and say, oh, but I'm over indebted. But brother, not over indebted because you have 10 houses and you've got a bond on every house and you're struggling to pay the bond of your 10 houses, so you consider yourself over indebted with a bank. That is not over indebted. That is taking advantage of the system. So what do we need to do? Gharimin is someone who is indebted with regards to the basic necessities of life. They have taken on a credit bread and milk from the store and they cannot afford to pay that credit. Not because they're gambling the other money, but because they generally can't afford. So you can assist that person with zakah. Maybe someone is 3 months behind with his rental, 3 months behind with his rental, and now he can't afford, he's going to be evicted. You can take your zakah, go to that person, help him, and he is over indebted with regards to a basic necessity of life. And I want to bring a point here, tie in at this point the issue of, because we only have like 5 minutes left, I want to tie in the issue of when I was working at the zakah fund. This is the issue of mawasat, of empathy and sympathy that we need to, that I'm trying to bring across here. Someone came and, you know, people put in the application that we need to receive some zakah. For what purposes? They must explain everything, whatever the case is. The person says, I am in need of a month rental, or 3 months rental, or arrears for my rental. Please give me zakat. So the application comes to me, and I look at it, and I think, now, why does this man wait for 3 months before he comes to the zakat fund? Now he's putting pressure on me to pay that money immediately, otherwise they're going to evict him. If this man came 2 months or 3 months ago, it would be easier. I mean, people mustn't do this, they mustn't. But I was thinking and speaking too fast. Because when I spoke to the man, I said, Buddha, why do you come so late? You could have come earlier. Now you wait till now, you're putting pressure on me. Now you phone me every day, when is it going to be paid? When is it going to be paid? When is it going to be paid? Why do you put pressure on me like that? He says, with tears in his eyes, do you know how difficult it is for me to come to the door of the zakat fund? Zakat is not something that I want to take. I am coming to you because it is my last resort to come to you. It's my last resort. Do you know how shy I feel to walk here to ask you for help? And when you hear these words, it shakes you a bit. Not a bit, a lot. You think to yourself that you were so arrogant or inconsiderate of someone's situation that you didn't really empathize and sympathize with them to understand that there is so much stigma attached by some people in the community for people who receive zakat, that it is so difficult for them to muster up the courage to present themselves and ask for a little bit of zakat to help in their needs. But what an indictment on our community that we don't have track and we don't have record of people that are struggling like this, so that we can automatically know before they ask, we can already know these people need our zakat. So sad. And this is why we understand the month of Ramadan, Shahr al-Mawasa, the month when we need to sympathize and empathize with people. So moving on, Ghareen, wa fi riqab came first, wa fi riqab, those people who are enslaved. Riqab, those people who are enslaved. Now today, you know, apparently, I say apparently for good reasons, apparently there is no slavery. Apparently there is no slavery. So you cannot free a slave anymore. Figuratively, we can say we are all slaves to this capitalistic system, we are all slaves to our bosses, everybody would like to claim that they are slaves to somebody, but we are not slaves, right? So, وَفِي الْعِقَابِ. So ulama have evolved the understanding of slavery to say that in today's day and age, وَفِي الْعِقَابِ, those who are enslaved, can also refer to people who are being held victims of human trafficking, people who are women who are being drugged and kept in countries by pimps, people who are prostituting them out to free these women. If you can pay for their release, then you can use zakah to pay and it will fall under the category of riqab. But this is how zakah is being developed. People who sit here in the jama'ah, you won't be surprised that as we speak, zakah is being developed so much. We need to become abreast with the different developments of zakat. Every time a new financial product gets released by Old Mutual or any other monetary organized financial institution, you need to understand what are the zakat implications of that. Time is catching up, 1 minute left. I want to end the ayah. وَالْغَارِمِ وَفِي سَبِيلِ وَفِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ وَفِي السَّبِيلِ. The last two categories. وَفِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ. In the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you may spend your zakat. Well, many people consider that to be jihad. We know that there is no amir or there is no khalifa calling for jihad directly. So even fi sabilillah, we know there are many people that are going to study the deen, that are using the pen and their mouths to defend Islam and are fighting the onslaught against Muslims with the pen and their mouth. So people who are studying for the deen, you are most welcome to use zakah in the category of fi sabilillah for them as well. The last category, wa min sabil, those wayfarers. If someone back in the day when a traveler came, as you would imagine and know very well, there was no internet banking in the time of Rasul. So obviously, if someone traveled, they would, even if they were wealthy, they didn't have access to the wealth immediately. So to allow that person to get back home or to give them a musafir khana, to give them a place to stay, you were permitted to use zakah for that. In today's day and age, people do have access to the wealth of their abroad. So we would consider many poor people, still there are many poor people who are traveling, who are come, who've come to South Africa, who don't have their means, then it is permissible to use zakah to make it easy for the traveler as well. Fariḍatan min Allah, this is a farḍ from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Wallahu alimun hakim. Allah is all knowing. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is all wise. Brothers and sisters, I leave you with this. Hopefully we have benefited, inshaAllah, from a small understanding about zakah. We can take this message to those who were not here, and maybe, inshaAllah, we can improve the development of zakah in South Africa. I hope I've done my duty, and Allah forgive me for my shortcomings. Wa ma alayna illa al-balagh al-mubin.
We say Jazakumullah to Moulana Sarfaraz Hamza for a beautiful talk on zakah. May we take heed of it. It's not our money. It has to go to where it belongs to. We are just a conduit where it's supposed to go to. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless Moulana and also give him shifa, because he's got a cold and been coughing, as you can hear. I did offer him water, so he said no after Jumuah. After the bottom. Well, after Jumuah is after Muhammad. Jazakumullah, beautiful speech, Papa. I'd like to think, Mawlana, that the masajids, the churches, the synagogues, and the NGOs are probably doing more for poverty alleviation than this government. It's something to think about, and I feel really, probably, that's how I feel. Subhanallah, if there's ever a mobilization force globally, it's the Muslims in the month of Ramadan, trying to alleviate people's misery, trying to alleviate people's problems. Again, thank you, Jazakumullah. Mawlana will do the khutbah as well as his salah for us, inshaAllah.